So I'd like to now end on the implications of our discussion around climate change and tenure and what you can do. I think to sort out strategies and steps forward, we need to adopt some principles for USAID programming on climate change, environment, and tenure. I would argue that the first step is to try to understand the problems that we've been discussing during this lecture. Understand how climate change and tenure are evolving over time in the particular place where you work or your specific area of geographical interest. Consider ways to build resiliency to climate change impacts in the work that you do, but resilience that takes account of how to create greater tenure security so that communities who have security and individuals who have security can be better enabled to resist the climate changes that are unfolding. I would argue that we need to continue, of course, to plan for adaptation because the world is changing, and to be aware that statutory and customary tenure systems are adapting, and that there is a role and a very important function that all of us have to play in how to encourage the clarification of resource tenure and property rights systems around bundles of natural resources, and that we as policymakers, academics, and implementers of development programs need to look very carefully at the role of tenure in all of our adaptation-oriented programming. But as we do that, we need to promote flexibility in tenure regimes. Flexibility in tenure regimes, allowing communities to move as they can in light of flooding, in light of droughts, in light of the other factors we've talked about that have to take account of the need to move massive amounts of people. I would argue that the territorial exclusion that we talked about is a model that will not work in the future. Customary tenure systems will have to adapt to allow people to come into their territories and at the same time create new laws, new regulations, new mechanisms to accept people coming in from the outside. Tenure systems need to be flexible. They can no longer be exclusive. This is going to happen at the local level. It's going to happen at the nation-state level when Pacific Islands go underwater in the decades to come. When people have to move off these islands, where do they go? Where do people from the lowlands of Bangladesh, Myanmar, and India move in the future? We're going to also have to be very skilled at managing conflicts around natural resources. We're going to have to become specialists as mediators in conflicts. We're going to have to understand the root causes of conflict. We're going to have to understand how to build institutions that better manage conflicts around natural resources. But while we do this, we need to keep one principle in very high standing, and that is how to build public participation for any and all actions around adaptation and mitigation to climate change. We're going to have to embrace the voluntary guidelines and other international principles that respect and encourage inclusive engagement in all social levels of society in decisions affecting their future around how they will adapt and respond to climate change. If civil society, if the public, in its many complex differentiated ways, are not involved in decisions around how to respond to climate change, conflict will continue to grow. So taking account of the voluntary guidelines that have been looked at in this course is one very, very important step. Those guidelines hopefully will evolve even more in the decades to come to take account of yet unimagined climate change impacts. So our takeaway message, tenure of security will be very, very important in the future. searching for greater security in land and property rights so as to consolidate and extend people's control over land and natural resource assets, and to provide incentives for good environmental stewardship, is one of the mantra of these times. How to create tenure security as an incentive for investment in good stewardship is a key principle. But at the same time, as I've just mentioned, maintaining flexibility of tenure regimes is vitally important. There needs to be greater flexibility to accommodate changes in land use and settlement patterns so as to provide the clear options for people in the anticipated context of greater demographic growth and mobility of growing populations that's provoked by climate-related threats to human settlements and livelihoods. So it's a horribly complex dilemma. How does one create greater security of tenure, yet also create flexibility of tenure as an incentive for responding to climate change? And indeed, the progressive land policies are emerging. The voluntary guidelines are some of the first, but hopefully there will be many, many more. So my last takeaway message is the following. We as citizens of the Earth need to learn about the interface between climate change, land tenure, and land policy. We have a responsibility for each and every one of us, in whatever domain we work, to learn about these realities around how climate is causing society to adapt. We need to become specialists in each of our own ways, looking at how land tenure regimes are evolving, how livelihoods are changing, how migration, displacement, struggles, and conflict are unfolding at this time. As citizens of the world, we must learn even more about the realities, but put this information into these conceptual models, like I introduced at the beginning of this lecture, to try to sort out and make sense to the bewildering flood of information that each of us encounter. But we cannot remain idle in the face of complex changes. Mitigation or responding to climate change is a global responsibility. I've been suggesting that the future directions are that we need to build climate resiliency that's adapted to local realities. We need to reduce carbon emissions. We need to promote low carbon economic growth. We need to seek out ways to store and absorb carbon in its many ways. We need to work to construct sustainable landscapes. We need to promote climate smart and climate sensitive agriculture. And for each one of these mitigation activities, land tenure and property rights issues will be at the forefront, without a doubt. It cannot be hidden. We need to understand the problem. We need to look at the biophysical effects. We need to look at those interrelationships from the mitigation lens and the adaptation lens to how resource tenure systems are changing. We need to work with policymakers and politicians and civil society and the private sector, the rich and the poor, to come up with land policies that respond to these crises of our times. That we need to try together in our own different ways to be part of the planning process, planning for an uncertain future, planning for how to live in a world affected by climate change, and strive all the time to search for equitable distribution of access, rights, and use of natural resources to assure that the benefits of secure tenure can touch and reach the poorest of the poor, who are the most vulnerable, the women, the children, the poorest men who do not have the assets to respond to the struggles of our times. Equitable tenure security is a question for the present. It's a question for generations not yet born. And we today have a resource that must be managed for the present and for the future. Thank you very much.